Blackstone Audio presents The Do-Re-Mi by Ken Kuhlken. This book is read by Ray Porter.
For Pam, so you can see how the world looked before you'd lived long enough to make it better. Chapter 1. Pop wanted me to practice law. USC admitted me to their Juris Doctorate program. So I asked Pop, are lawyers crooks to begin with? Or does being a lawyer make them crooks? The sun was falling fast toward the Rubicons across Lake Tahoe from our cottage. Pop stood over the steaks he was grilling. Mama had gone inside for mosquito repellent. For the past half hour, Pop and I had discussed the San Francisco Chronicle's latest revelations about President Nixon's Watergate blunder. Pop used the Chronicle to fan smoke out of his face.
"Nobody's anything to begin with," he said. "Lawyers can go bad, but you're not that kind of man."
Pop was usually right. That time, he was dead wrong. Later that summer, on the last Wednesday in August 1972, I drove north on Highway 101 into the Redwoods. The two-lane highway was cluttered with hippie vans, sputtering VWs, and family wagons descending upon the town of Evergreen. Hippies claimed Evergreen was the closest place on Earth to Eden. I wouldn't have disputed their claim. The air was crisp, with a mild salty tang and the seductive fragrance of redwoods. Because of the mountains that horseshoed around the valley, leaving one side open to the breezes off the Pacific 20 miles west, Evergreen was an ecosystem apart, with balmy winters and summers cooled by mists and night rains that blew away at dawn over the Trinity Wilderness. Most of us crowding the highway had come for Big Dan Mills' jamboree. I believed that weekend would change my life. I only hoped it would change for the better. The jamboree was a folk festival. Over the past 3 years, it had become a major event. Even while half the people who used to talk politics in coffee houses had turned to dropping LSD and spacing out on electric guitars. My brother Alvaro had convinced Big Dan to invite me to perform. I would be on stage Sunday, just before the finale. In my daydreams, it was my chance to turn pro, to meet record producers and earn a shot at playing clubs like the Troubadour in Hollywood. At least I might land a booking agent and give myself a solid reason to forget USC, where I was supposed to start law school in 20 days. As I passed a sign marking 12 miles to Evergreen, I was trying to decide what to play. I wished to God I had written even two good songs, but so far the only tunes or lyrics that came to mind when I picked up my guitar were those I had heard. Besides, I didn't feel wise enough about the world to write honest yet meaningful words. Pop said the songs would come after I had experienced more. Most of the people whose songs I played were coming to the jamboree. Lightnin' Hopkins, my favorite living blues man, was coming. Ramblin' Jack Elliott, who had been pals with Woody Guthrie, would be talking about Woody and playing Woody's songs. Tom Paxton was coming, and Dino Valenti. Richard Farina was dead, but his wife Mimi was on the bill. I wouldn't risk her displeasure by doing any of Farina's songs. Buffy St. Marie was coming, which meant I wouldn't play the Peter Lafarge numbers I knew. They were about Indians, which was her territory, not mine. Rumors had circulated that Bob Dylan meant to show up, forsake his rock and roll ways, turn back to standing alone with his acoustic guitar and harmonica, and rekindle the folk scene. Maybe a Stephen Foster number would work, I thought. Maybe Beautiful Dreamer, one of Mama's favorites. Alvaro could help me choose. I hoped to find my brother tonight. I hadn't seen him much in the past few years since he left for Vietnam. And I was anxious to show him my new guitar, a Gibson Hummingbird, my 22nd birthday present from Pop. I had lusted after a hummingbird since Alvaro taught me to play. I believed our family was blessed. Mama appeared to be healing, and, as far as we knew, Alvaro had stayed out of trouble for months now. 10 miles south of Evergreen, I slowed to observe three kids who could pass for Cupids. They and a man stood with bowed heads around a simple cross of redwood branches in a ditch beside the highway. Grieving for a Mexican friend, I thought. Along the roads of Mexico, people marked the site of each fatal crash with a cross or shrine. The man slouched beside the cross. He had strawberry blonde hair, long, wavy, and braided. The kids' white ringlets.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.